हुजूर पूछ रहे हैं कि क्या बागी लोग क्या करते हैं, क्या वो आपके गांव में आते हैं और सब कुछ जला के छोड़ जाते हैं और हर एक चीज़ को तबाह बर्बाद कर जाते हैं और फिर लाइबेरिया के बॉर्डर में वापस चले जाते हैं। मेहमान बता रहे हैं कि वो पहले वो लाइबेरिया वापस चले जाते थे लेकिन अब वो लाइबेरिया वापस नहीं जाते, उन्होंने मुल्क के कुछ हिस्सों पर कब्जा कर लिया हुआ है और वहाँ पर रहते हैं। हजूर पूछ रहे हैं कि आप में से मैंडेज कितने हैं और चिमनीज कितने हैं। पहले मेहमान जो हैं वो मैंडे हैं और तीसरे मेहमान जो हैं वो भी मैंडे हैं और दरमियान वाले जो हैं मेरा ख्याल है कि वो चिमनी हैं। वो अपने इलाकों के बारे में बता रहे हैं और वो बता रहे हैं कि बागी लोगों ने सड़क को बंद कर दिया था और मेरा इलाका जो है वो उनके कब्ज़े में है। हज़रत फरमा रहे हैं कि उनको बागी क्यों कहा जाता है। वो हमला करने वाली फ़ौज हैं और उनको एक गैर मुल्की ताकत जो है वो कंट्रोल कर रही है और वो इस अगर वो इस मुल्क में कोई इनकलाब लाना चाहते हैं तो फिर वो इस मुल्क को बिल्कुल ही तबाह व बर्बाद ना कर देते। और इसका मतलब ये है कि ये लोग दूसरे किसी हुकूमत के हाथ में खेल रहे हैं। मेहमान कह रहे हैं कि हम यकीन रखते हैं कि गैर मुल्की ताकतें ऐसी हैं जो इन बागियों को कंट्रोल कर रही हैं। हज़रत फरमा रहे हैं कि जब वो आपके मुल्क में आके तबाह व बर्बाद करते हैं और फिर वापस अपने मुल्क में चले जाते हैं और इस तरह से मालूम होता है कि वो गैर मुल्की लोग हैं और यही वो लोग हैं जो फिर यूनाइटेड नेशन में शिकायतें करते हैं और वो कहते हैं कि फोडसन का जो है वो हर दिल अजीज लीडर नहीं है और टेलर जो है वो ही सारा काम करवा रहा है और आप लोगों की या वहाँ के जो अफ्रीका के मुल्कों के एसोसिएशन है उनका उसके बारे में क्या ख्याल है और उनकी रिपोर्ट जो है वो यूनाइटेड नेशंस को उस पर गौर करना चाहिए लेकिन उसका असर क्या होगा कि अगर ये आदमी है वो बिल्कुल आज़ाद हो जाए और वो तबाह व बर्बादी शुरू कर दे और उसको हर तरह की इमदाद भी दी जा रही है और हालात जो हैं ये बहुत ज़्यादा संगीन हो चुके हैं। हज़रत फरमा रहे हैं कि मुझे इस बात पर यकीन नहीं आता कि ये बात जो आम गलतफहमी के तौर पर है और जितने लोगों को मैं मिला हूँ उन्होंने मुझे ये चीज़ बताई है कि ये ताकतें जो कि मिस्टर टेलर की हमायत कर रही हैं वो मगरबी दुनिया को ये यकीन दिलाना चाहती हैं कि ये शख्स जो है उसकी लीबिया हमायत कर रहा है और लीबिया उसकी पसे पुश्त पर है। और अफ्रीकन लोग या अफ्रीका के जो यूनियन है वो ये बात जो है फैला रही है और वो सिरा लियोन के लोगों को और दूसरे लोगों को ये यकीन दिलाना चाहते हैं कि मिस्टर टेलर और उसकी जो फौजें हैं वो लीबिया की पुश्त पनाही में हैं और वो उनकी मदद कर रहा है और वो ये कहते हैं कि लीबिया हमारी मदद कर रहा है। अगर ये इस तरह से होता तो फिर बस مغربی طاقتیں ان کی مدد نہ کرتیں اور کیونکہ یہ دونوں متضاد چیزیں ہیں کہ لیبیا کی حکومت بھی ان کی مدد کرے اور مغربی طاقتیں بھی ان کی مدد کریں یہ چیزیں جو ہیں وہ کچھ بھی معنی نہیں رکھتے اور وہ لوگ جو کہ حالات کو جانتے ہیں اور حقیقت سے واقف ہیں وہ ان حملہ کرنے والی فوجوں کی مدد کر رہے ہیں اور ان کو ہر طرح سے مالی امداد اور دوسری امداد دی جا رہی ہے اگر یہ لیبیا اس کی ہمدردی کر رہا ہوتا تو مغربی حکومت یا یورپین حکومت جو ہے وہ اپنی ان کی مدد سے ہاتھ کھینچ لیتا کیونکہ یہ دونوں ایک دوسرے کی مخالف یا دشمن طاقتیں ہیں اور وہ کسی طرح بھی یہ قدم نہ اٹھاتے کہ جس کو قذافی جو ہے وہ اس کی مدد کر رہا ہے تو مغربی طاقتیں بھی اسی باغی لیڈر کی مدد کریں مہمان کہہ رہے ہیں کہ اسی سلسلے میں ہم آپ سے یہ درخواست کرنا چاہتے ہیں کہ آپ ہماری دعاؤں سے ہماری مدد کریں حضور فرما رہے ہیں کہ میں ہمیشہ آپ کی مدد کرتا ہوں اور آپ کا ملک جو ہے وہ میرے ذہن میں رہتا ہے کیونکہ اس کے حالات جو ہیں بہت سنگین ہیں اور وہاں پر احمدیت اور خاص کر مینڈے لوگوں نے احمدیت کی بہت زیادہ مدد کی تھی اس لیے میں نے یہ پوچھا تھا کہ آپ میں سے کتنے مینڈے ہیں اور جہاں تک ٹیمی لوگوں کا تعلق ہے مجھے ان سے کوئی بھی شکایت نہیں ہے لیکن مجھے یہ احساس یہ بھی معلوم ہے کہ ٹیمنی جو ہے وہ بہت تعداد میں احمدیت میں شامل ہو جاتے ہیں اور اگر کویت ملک کا کوئی رہنما وہاں آتا ہے یہ
They said, no, it was just a small thing. We are with you. La ilaha ulai, la ilaha ulai. So I hope all the Timinis don't behave like that. Only it's in a small pocket. But of Mendes, I've never heard such a thing. They're brave, faithful, honest people. When they side with somebody, and they too genuinely side with that faction or group or jamaat. Huh?
Yes, the body
is that right, my analysis of the Mandy's character, or is it wrong? Tell
no,
me.
No, it's correct. I think Mr. Actor, having been there, should. Huh? So Mr. Actor, who was there for a long time, knows.
Oh, he would know, yes.
You are quite true. That you are quite correct.
My assessment about the general characters of Timinis and Mandy's is correct?
Oh. It's quite correct. It's correct. I mean, Timnis who are also very good.
Mm-hmm. I know.
But as you have said, the fraction, there is a fraction.
Mm-hmm. Fraction?
Yeah, fraction of Timnis who will go out to the either side. Okay.
Mm-hmm. No, what I had in mind was that maybe our experience regarding a certain pocket was a particular experience. We should not have generalized it. I don't know much about the Timnis in all over the country. But one other thing which I don't like is that the so-called leader Sanko is a Timini.
He's a Timini.
That's right.
But in his case, I don't think Timinis are supporting him.
No.
So that's a good thing in favor of Timinis. Although the leader which they created, the leader of rebellion, who doesn't mean anything anyway.
That's right.
He is just a figure, you know, a facade.
Yeah.
No more. But despite the fact that he belongs to the Timinis, I don't find any evidence of Timinis supporting him.
No.
It's not a tribal warfare at all.
No.
Right?
Yeah, you're right. Completely correct.
It's only sad that it is the Middle Land that is suffering now.
That's right.
Yes,
that's
and they have suffered terribly.
Correct.
I think that's because the land was nearest to the Liberian border. That is.
Right. All right, shall we start again now? Start to the... I don't know what you have in mind. Tell me what you have in mind.
Well, to begin with, Uzu, I would like to thank you very much for seeing us. And we hope that talking to you today would extend our knowledge and blessings to not
Well, the pleasure is mine, if not entirely, largely mine, because you have come from from different places, different places, covered long distances.
Yes, I just
come and meet us.
Introduce us. Yes. My name is Kai Musapukawa. Yes, I've seen him many times here.
Yes. But many who haven't seen you before, would you kindly introduce yourself at some length?
Yes, sir. I am a born Ahmadi.
Yes, mashallah.
And
when was your father? When did your father convert to Ahmadiyya?
He was an Ahmadi before I was born.
Yes.
I have never really found
out. No, I don't know. You remember the time of your birth.
Yes.
But you might have heard from
Yes, he tells me stories, but because he was not very educated, he was not educated. So in terms of dates, precise dates,
right,
he was able
to tell. So he generally used to tell.
Generally, he tells me that
in
he
whose
was
time?
An Ahmadi.
Do you remember that?
This was
Nazir Ali's time, Hazrat Maulana Ali's time.
Yes, indeed. Sir.
He would be one of the earliest ones.
That's right, sir. Right. And
it's around about 60 years since Ahmadiyya got rooted in Sierra Leone, yes, and ever since it has been progressing uninterrupted.
Years,
yes.
Yes, sir.
MashaAllah.
And so I then attended all the Ahmadiyya schools in Sierra Leone. The Ahmadiyya Primary School in Sierra Leone and the Ahmadiyya Secondary School, which was the first in Bo. Mm-hmm. So all my education was in Bo.
That was the first Ahmadiyya school?
In Bo. Mm-hmm. And during our time, we were helping to build the school.
Right.
The students at weekends, we helped to build the school.
Right.
So
we did Bukhari Amal there.
We did, sir. So the, my education was there. So I, that's my only education in Sierra Leone. Mm-hmm. I came to England and I studied here in universities. I became a lawyer. And I've been working here since 1982.
Since 1982, you have settled here?
Yes, sir. I met you a couple of times when I wanted to go back.
I remember.
And I was seeking your advice.
I'm asking these questions.
Yes, sir.
So that you tell the others, the viewers, that
yes, sir,
who you are. You know, that's.
Indeed,
of course, I remember everything. So tell them.
Yes, since 1982, I was working for the London Borough of Lambeth.
That's right, yes.
For about 8 years. And. I sought your advice on a number of occasions whether to go back, and my parents, my family wanted me to go and become drain politics, and I sought your advice a number of occasions. And I'm now in private practice, I have my own practice.
And it seems you followed the advice as well.
Indeed, sir.
And now you don't have to repent.
I don't have any regrets. I always go to listen to your advice.
Right.
Also. And
next.
My colleague is Mr. Mohammed.
Will you introduce him or he would introduce himself?
My name is Mohammed Van de Bokare. I was converted by Mirza Hanif Ahmad, your brother.
Yes, you used to be in his house.
In the house as a housewife.
Yes, you lived with him. You shared the same house with him,
yes,
while you were a student.
Yes, sir.
And he was very kind to you. Still, you remember him with such love?
Yes.
I know that.
Mr. Ella Mahmoud, who is now the current principal of the school.
Yes, I know Lutfur Rahman Mahmoud.
Yes, yes.
He was also there. They were together, both Mr. Hanif Ahmad and.
No, it was after Mr. Hanif Ahmad.
He left, yes.
So I really signed by the time
correct
of Mr. Ella Mahmoud.
Mm-hmm.
That was way back in 1964.
Right.
So when I left the school, I came back there as a teacher.
Right.
I served under Mr. Akhtar as the senior boardroom master,
mm-hmm,
as boss of the school.
Mm-hmm.
Before I came, I was the boardroom master and the finance secretary of the mission for the Southern region. So when I came here, I joined my brother. He has been helping me.
Mm-hmm.
I'm studying and working with him at the same time. But I found out that I'd be very useful in Syria and in the field of Islam. So why should I be wasting? So we met together with Mr. Akhtar to say that we should have a Syria index, so I can still be serving Islam, even while here. So currently,
you have not been here very long, have you?
No, it's just about 2 years. Sir.
Just 2 years?
Yes, sir.
How do I know that? You didn't tell me how long you have been here.
Okay, sorry about it.
Huh?
Sorry about it.
You see, his pronunciation is so clear, one can immediately guess that he must have been here for a long time. And yours is still, some, you know, with some ceremony.
Mm-hmm.
Influence on your pronunciation. So, for those who have not trained ears to understand the Sierra Leone English, they may find it a bit difficult.
Indeed.
So, in that case, it's better for you to speak, you know, at a slow pace, slowly, word for word, because it's not just me. I will, of course, I understand. I know.
Mm-hmm.
But those who are listening to you and viewing you on television, they might find it a bit difficult if you speak at that pace. Okay?
So currently, I'm the general secretary of the Serendis.
Currently, you are the general secretary. Yeah. That is what you mean.
Yes. Yes.
Good. Yes?
I'm Dauda M. Sharif, born of an Ahmadi in Bauma.
Bauma. Oh, yes, I know Bauma. Yes.
Bauma, and that is very close to Bo.
Of course.
My father was a late Sheriff Sanko. Yeah, they were the first Ahmadis who signed in the hands of the first missionary, Nazir Ahmad, in Bauma.
That's right.
He was based at Bauma. They only moved to Bo later on.
Correct.
With late Alhaji Rogers, late Saidu Bangura, and late
Saidu Bangura.
Yeah.
That's right, yes.
So they were all together.
Right.
And they moved to Bo later. I attended school there, came to Bo. I also attended the Ahmadiyya Secondary School. And I went for teacher training. Mm-hmm. After teacher training, I taught in my primary school, Bo Ahmadiyya Primary School. Mm-hmm. I also taught in the secondary school under Pa Akta, who was very, very resourceful.
He helped
us to really understand the work as a teacher.
Right.
Then later, fortunately, I was recruited to serve in teacher training in the country, and I also served as research assistant at Jala University College.
In which area? Research?
Geography.
Geography?
Yeah. So I came...
Were you given any project regarding some parts of Sierra Leone or research project in geography?
No, yes. I was working with some lecturers undertaking research, but mainly in conservation.
That's
and
right.
We used to go to Kailan, which is now under this red
zone.
Yeah. In fact, I came here in 1990 at... University of...
What are they doing to your diamonds?
Well, sir, I was nothing. Only
oh, the robbers and the invaders?
The invaders were stealing.
Helping themselves with both hands?
Mm-hmm.
But do they have enough labor to dig them willingly for them?
Well, the people are forced to... They use people as forced labor.
Oh, I know, they're forced labor. But people have generally fled from those areas, haven't they?
Indeed, sir.
So there will be very few people left for them to be employed in this.
Those they capture, they bring them along with them and force them to.
Now, your turn, please.
Well, my name is...
And you're all married, aren't you?
No, I'm not.
You're not.
I'm not yet.
So that is why, you know, I asked this question. These three are, but you're not. And you have three children?
I have two.
Two.
So,
and you?
I have one. So when
just
I go,
one?
Just one. When I go, was going to get married,
that's not proper.
But
I say, I'm going to have only one child so far.
When I was going to get married.
It's too little. What?
When I was going to get married, you gave me a present.
Yes.
From my wife.
Yes, that's right.
And I have dedicated all my children to the service of Ahmadiyya.
Inshallah.
The first one is called Tahir Ahmad. The second one is called Nasir Ahmad.
Good. And your children?
I have five children. One is in Form 5.
That's more like the Savior's traditions. Not very much, but somewhat, yes. You know, in Nigeria, they have, mashallah, Ahmadi families are having large number of children they're raising, and they're very fond of, they're very proud of having large number of children. So much so that one Nigerian lady requested my wife when she went to Nigeria with me to ask me for prayer to have more children. In fact, what she said was, my wife understood was, she wanted to have children. So she thought that she had no children. So she pitied her and interceded on her behalf, asking me for prayer. And then she told me that she felt so sorry for her in the beginning. But when she inquired, how long have you been married? And don't you have a single child? He said, no, I have 19 children. 19 from the same mother, imagine. And she wanted some more. What a brave lady. And she was very healthy, strong. Surprising. I don't think in any other country you can find the like of her. With such strong physique, having given birth to 19 children, still yearning for more. But this is not bad. This is not a joke. This is not something laughable. Because it falls in line with an instruction of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said that you marry waludan wadudan, women or girls who are very loving and also bear many children. At one time he said, I like during the day, at the day of resurrection, to lead the largest ummah in the whole history of mankind. And I like you to give birth to more children. So I started in a light manner, as if I was just telling you a joke, but it is not a joke. I love Ahmadis to have more children. You see, that is one of the reasons, but one of the original factors which led me on to the scheme of Waqf-e-Nau. You know, when the need for this led me on to this beautiful idea, and it was developed by God later on into such a wonderful scheme. So I am just speaking of my mind loudly, not only to share with you, but with the rest of the audience and television. Mm-hmm. Those Ahmadi couples who can bear more children, they should go for it, because they are going to save the world. We need people like Ahmadis, more in number, as much as possible, so that they discharge their responsibilities, within their means, without extending their efforts over much. Okay? Please.
Well, my name is Muhammad Kamara.
And now you have decided to marry very soon and bring
inshallah, inshallah.
Raise a large family, right?
Yes, inshallah.
Kamara.
Yes, Kamara.
Right.
I did my primary.
Which Kamara family do you belong to?
Well,
where Khalid is married?
No, Huzur.
Not the same Kamaras.
No, Huzur.
Right.
Yeah. I did my primary education in Ahmadiyya Primary School Bo.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, Ahmadiyya Secondary School Bo.
Mm-hmm.
And from there, I taught for 1 year at Nasir Ahmadiyya Secondary School Kenema.
You taught there at MashaAllah. Yes.
So I did the secondary school under the principalship of Mr. B.A. Akhtar.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Who is fortunately here.
Yes, he was also at one time.
He must be very proud of seeing his pupils.
Oh, yes.
Then after that, I did 4 years program at Jala University College. After reaching to you so many letters for prayers, for guidance, and as to go through one of your prayers, I got a scholarship. I went to Russia. Yeah, I studied medicine. Inshallah, I finished 1993 by the grace of Allah. And I'm now trying to attempt exams here in the UK.
Are you well versed in Russian?
Yes,
to the extent that you can translate my addresses simultaneously, or not yet?
Huzur, that's difficult.
Written word, books or small pamphlets into Russian?
Huzur, I can do that.
Yes, you can. So why don't you try your hand at that? We need so much help in this regard. There's so much demand and a rising demand from the erstwhile USSR countries. And they want more and more literature. You know, they can't satiate their desire for more Islamic literature. So you better help. You offer yourself to Tabshir. Inshallah. Okay. And now, something about yourself. Of course, we know you, but not all the viewers, because this program is being seen all over the world, even Bangladesh, up to Japan, in all corners of India, and Sri Lanka, Burma, etc. I hope Burma have got the permission. I know one man had an dish antenna installed privately, and the Jamaat used to go there. But I think there are some risks involved. The government wouldn't say it is legal, wouldn't say it's illegal. They want to keep the right to move in their own hands. Whenever they don't like somebody, they can come back and, bring the heavy hand of law on such people, saying this is not legal. But when you write to them officially, they wouldn't answer you. But this gentleman, he has taken a risk on his own. And with the grace of Allah, the Jamaat is gathering at his house, as many as they can. So they would also be viewing you and they would like to know more about you.
Yeah.
Bengal, in Bangladesh, everywhere.
Hazur, my name is Bashir Ahmad Akhtar. Mm-hmm. And after passing the MSc exam from the Punjab University, I dedicated myself.
Mm-hmm.
And
were you not educated at TA College?
Yes, I passed my BSc honors. I was the first student to do BSc.
To do the honors, so mashallah. In physics?
In chemistry.
In chemistry, right.
And then I went to the Punjab University and had my MSc in 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
And then I...
After the honors, you can do it in 1 year.
Yeah, after the honors. So after that, I went to Tabshir and Maulvi Nazir Ahmed Sahib were there, Nazir Ahmed Mubashir Sahib.
Achha, right.
And he told me to go to Sierra Leone quickly. Right. And I said, yes, I'm ready.
Okay.
And I think by that time, my result was not out yet. Mm-hmm. So in March 65, 23rd March 65, I was in Sierra Leone.
MashaAllah.
And...
how long did you serve there?
22 years. 22
Continuously?
Years. Continuous.
MashaAllah.
Yes. And then...
Your children, how many children were born and raised there?
4 children, 2 daughters and 2 sons. They were born there, they were educated there, and now they are with me.
And they are also very good in education, aren't they? Exceptional, some of them, I understand.
Yes, they...
One girl of yours who came with you, you know?
Yes, she's there.
She appeared to be outstanding in her performance in university studies.
Yes, she's now joining university this year. Okay. She has done A-level.
Good.
And
she's the youngest?
She's the youngest.
Right. And about the other boys and girls?
Yeah, one is doing second year electronics engineering in UCL.
Is he also faring well in...
Yeah, he's trying.
Good performance?
Yeah, good performance. We need Hazul's place.
And one daughter is married, I know.
Yeah, she's in Lahore.
Yeah. Is she happy?
She's quite happy.
How many grandchildren do you have so far?
Two now.
Two now?
Two.
Good. So the Imam Sahib, of course, everybody knows.
Yeah. Huh? So I served 3 schools in Sierra Leone. Mm-hmm. 2 years I spent in Freetown. That was the second school, just opened by that time. Then I was promoted as principal of Ahmadiyya Bojibu. I spent 7 years over there. And then the rest of the 15 years, I was in Bo.
You see, it's a very Ahmadiyya good program Bo. In English, of course, mm-hmm. because all Europeans and non-Urdu speaking people can understand English well, or somewhat at least.
Yes.
Even in Japan, English is now becoming a sort of world lingua franca.
It is.
But the problem with me is that there's a very large number of Ahmadis, not only in Pakistan, but India, even Bangladesh and here in Europe, who cannot understand English much. The German Ahmadis, the large number of Ahmadis from Pakistan, about, I don't know exact number, but large number, they either know Punjabi or Urdu or German, no English. And most of the Pakistani Ahmadis who would be watching us, they would not understand a word of Urdu.
No.
English, I'm sorry.
English.
Even the Punjabi speaking can understand what we are talking about in generalities if they don't understand all the things I say in Urdu, but in general they are with us. But in case of English, there are very few people, I think, except for in the cities, even there, the standard of English is not very high nowadays in Pakistan. People write to me, although they are educated to the degree of having degrees, yet they say we find it a bit difficult to follow these programs. We enjoy Urdu programs much. So, if you don't mind, let me tell them a few words, speak to them in Urdu, a few words in Urdu, and tell them what's happening. Right? If they have already not got bored or dozed off, they may enjoy knowing what's happening here. But maybe this program is translated into Urdu as well. I remember having instructed that this program should be translated into in Urdu channel, the second channel. Said sir?
Yes,
sir. Is it right?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. So there's no problem. Then they can just watch me on this and hear the translator on the other channel. Right?
That's good.
So anything else you would like to say?
Manuzu, we generally wanted to share your vast knowledge in terms of some items, some questions that
please,
as Muslims ahead. Had bothered us. We thought we can share this with you. You can enlighten us. I've got one or two questions, time permitting. My first concern, Uzu, is about the idea of marriage. Having spent some time in this country, I find that the Western concept of marriage is one wife. Obviously, there's an Islamic concept that you can't marry more than one wife. Sorry. But I wanted to know, where did the Christian concept that one should only marry one wife come from? Whether that's written or it's just made up in some...
Now, that is a great mystery. Because as far as the Jewish literature is concerned, Old Testament, etc., and all the other literature, apocryphal literature, they mention the prophets having married even to the extent of 100 wives, And if not prophets, the kings, but also prophets are told to have married twice, more than once. Hazrat Abraham married his wife Sarah and then Hajra, although she was previously a born woman, but after she came into marriage, she belonged to a royal family. She was a regular wife. According to the Bible, we know she became a regular wife. Again, Hazrat Yaqub had two wives and two born women, as they call them. Again, obviously, according to that custom, they were considered as his wives. They gave birth to many children. So, as far as the history of Bible is concerned, we understand history with reference to the Bible, is concerned. We know most certainly that this was the Judaic practice, which was handed down to the Christians of the time of Jesus Christ. Now, what we find in Jesus Christ is his personal example was that he does not seem to have married, not to our knowledge anyway. So the issue for the Christians is either to marry more or permit themselves to marry more than once or not to marry at all. This halfway situation of not marrying more than once, but marrying all the same, has no authenticity. I have discussed this matter with some Jehovah Witnesses who came to meet me, and they quoted some biblical passages attributed to Christ who said this and that. Mm-hmm. But they were just very small reflections on some situation. They cannot be taken seriously to be a very positive statement of Jesus Christ annulling the previous teaching and introducing a new one. That's what I'm talking about. In general terms, what we find is that Jesus said, I have not come to change or cancel an iota of the Torah or the book. So that means they have no authority to change the Jewish teachings of the Torah, which permitted people to marry more than once. Now, as far as the number four is concerned, they should not remain confined to, if they marry more than once, to the limit of four, because it is the Islamic limit imposed, not the Judaic. So, as far as Jewish religion is concerned, that should be still the religion of Christians. in ordinary life, in do's and do nots. And it is only St. Paul, you know, he deviated from this tradition. But I'm surprised at the Christians who, knowing full well that St. Paul had never received any instruction from Jesus Christ, while James, the rightful successor of Jesus, and others who were brought up under his instruction, they continuously struggled against Paulian tendency to break away from Judaism. And this remained adamant till the end that we do follow and the law of the Torah, and it is still binding on us. So as far as genuine authority after Jesus Christ is concerned, we can say with full confidence that they believed in the law of Torah to be still operative at that time. So then, in view of what I have said, the options for the Christians are simply twofold. Either to follow Torah and permit themselves to marry even 100 times if they so like. Legally, I mean, not illegally as they are doing. And or to follow the holy example of Jesus Christ and follow the example of Catholic Church as far as their ministers and religious hierarchy is concerned, they don't marry. Following the Jesus example of Jesus, peace be upon him. So there is at least some consistency in their behavior.
Indeed.
Although this consistency is only in application to religious office holders, the clergy, official clergy. But from that at least we understand that this, they believe what a true Christian should be, the ideal Christian should be. So if they do this, all of them, then what would happen? Almost entire America and Europe will be deprived of the second generation Christians forever, and third and fourth, you know. Mm-hmm. So it is a teaching which, if practiced seriously and in all earnest, would bring the entire Christianity to an end after one generation. So obviously this could not be what God meant, what God did. So I agree with the early Christians. I fully support the view of St. James and others that Christianity was only a continuity of Judaic faith, and Judaic practices should continue to lead the Christian life, day-to-day life. Right?
Thank you, sir.
Also, tribalism is the root cause of many bloodshed in most parts of the world.
Many?
Bloodshed is a result for bloodshed in many parts of the world. Example?
Bloodshed. Right, I'm sorry, again, you see?
Example, South Africa, Burundi, Liberia.
That's right.
What does Islam say about tribalism?
Islam totally stamps out even the smallest roots of racialism. And they were stamped out under the feet of Hazrat Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam on the day of the last sermon of Hajj, that great Hajj sermon. And he said, I trample these false traditions under my feet, this holy day, this holy month. And never after this should you ever think in terms of tribalism, racialism, color, creed, etc., etc. Human beings are all one. So that is the glorious teaching of Islam, the only glorious teaching of Islam which can win the world the much sought for peace, which unfortunately is evading our desires to achieve it.
Huzu, like pork meat, monkey has become a popular meat among non-Muslims in West Africa, especially Sierra Leone. I want to know.
And also, mouse. Huh? Rats.
So I want to know the state of monkey as a meat in Islam.
Well, it lies, I think, on the borderline. Although I would never dream of any Ahmadi eating monkey's flesh, but I am answering you purely from the point of view of jurisprudence. If monkey can be described to belong to the category of animals who prey on others, who survive on other animals by preying on them, then of course it would be forbidden. But if it is considered to be mainly a herbivorous species, not a carnivorous, a species which survives on vegetable, fruit, etc., then of course it could be considered whether the meat of monkey is permissible or not. But it stands halfway on this side, halfway on the other. Monkeys are known, like human beings, to devour both meat and vegetables at the same time. So you have asked me a very difficult question. This should be addressed to the full house of our jurisprudence, Medisefta. And they should study some more about it. If it is a beast, of course, then it is forbidden. Beast in the sense like wolves, like dogs, like lions, tigers, etc., then it is not permitted in Islam. But if you pull it more towards the border of vegetarian animals, then of course you could consider it. But what is your natural response to this question? Do you think it's good to eat monkeys or?
Well, personally, I feel no.
No.
But Muslims in Sierra Leone,
they don't
eat monkeys.
That's good.
Yeah.
But it's not true of all the Muslims in Africa. Muslims in some parts of Africa do eat monkeys. You know that?
I don't know.
The Sierra Leone Muslims are a model for the rest of Africa in that case. And what about rats?
Rats, yeah, people do eat that in Sierra Leone. I don't.
I know you don't, but, but the Muslims do.
Yes,
some Muslims do.
And with such relish, don't they?
These are special rats that are hunted.
I'll come to that. You know, once I received a letter...
Don't qualify it.
Once I received a letter from a principal, maybe it was he or somebody else, he said that this day was entirely lost, no studies. And then he explained, because a student detected a rat and the class ran to catch the rat and all the other classes follow suit. And the whole school spent the day on the rat hunting. And he didn't specifically tell me whether ultimately the rat was caught by them or not, but the day was destroyed. So I was surprised why we are so fond of catching rats or hunting rats. So I inquired from the Mishnah in charge. And he told me, he wrote me a detailed letter, that rat is one of the most delicious, you know, animals, according to the experience here, and it is very well much prized. So I had yet to wait until I could see with my own eyes what was happening. So when I visited Ghana, I saw a place where they made tikkas. You know tikkas?
Mm-hmm.
Shish kebabs.
Yes.
And there were two shops, one on this side, one the other. One shop was crowded by people, you know, the long queue. And the other was just so-so. So there, the tikkas of ordinary meat was sold where the people not much interested. And the one with long queues, there they specialized in rat tikkas. You see? So that is, that shows the common popularity of this. So once I remember, I saw some, you know, as you travel along the road, there's some makeshift arrangements for shops, small markets everywhere in Africa. Some people from the nearby village bring their some produce and sell it on the roadside, and this attracts the tourists, etc., and they get some more price. So there were two things hanging. One was a smoked rat, a small one, about that big, and the one was an antelope, large, antelope. Wonderful antelope, deer, you know, type of deer. So I stopped the car there. I told them, let me find out how much does this sell. So I don't remember the exact figure, but the price of the rat was three times that of the antelope. You see? Yeah. I was absolutely, you know, flabbergasted. I said, what do you mean? It's a small thing, and rat for that matter, you know. On top of that, it's a rat. And this is, he said, no, we sell according to the demand. People like this more, so why should we charge them more for this? So that put me on to further research, and now I come to the last point you raised. It was disclosed that the word rat is common, but it is not the rat you think of. It's an animal found in the jungle, which is considered, which is called perhaps something in African languages as grass cutter or something.
Yeah,
grass cutter. Yes. Right. And it is not the household rat which we are thinking of. So I want you to tell the rest of the world, they might have heard these stories, they should know the background as well.
That's right.
It's only the name rat which it shares. It's a wild animal, and people, of course I couldn't bring myself up to eat it, but the people who eat it, they tell me it is exceptionally delicious. And there's nothing wrong with that. It's not the rodent rat we know. It lives openly in the jungle. Of course, it's a rodent, but otherwise, it has a fresh, healthy look and fresh, healthy habits. Right?
It disturbs farmers in Sierra as well.
What?
It disturbs Sierraians.
Right.
Who are farmers.
I see. Right.
So they make a lot of traps to catch them.
Quite.
Well, Hozu, the word apostasy has become a political issue all over the world.
What has?
Apostasy.
Apostasy?
Yeah.
Right.
And a lot of persecutions actually of Muslims, especially Ahmadis in Pakistan, for instance, are based on the fact that they are apostate or something like that. Now, was the question of apostasy ever dealt with at the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how?
We know that anybody was free to accept and relinquish Islam, it's too light. I know one in Wadi, Bedouin or some guest from some different place from the desert, he came and accepted Islam readily and stayed the night there. And next morning he changed his mind. So he addressed Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, return my Islam to me, you know, as if it was some commodity he had given over and he wouldn't leave without it. So Rasulullah was surprised and he tried to make him understand what, you know, it's wrong decision. But he said, no, I have decided, so give me back my Islam. So poor man, you know, a very thick-headed person it appears. So Rasulullah said, all right, I return it, don't worry, this is your choice. So Islam was free to accept and free to leave. There was no compulsion. And that is a picture painted by the Holy Quran, that la ikraha fi al-deen, qad tabayyana ar-rushd min al-ghayy, faman yakfur bit-taghuti wa yu'min billahi, faqad istamsaka bil-urwati al-wuthqa, la inqisama laha. There's no compulsion in religion. None. God has made the truth manifestly clear. So it's up to you, anybody else, to accept it or not to accept it. But those who accept it, because they willingly accept it, their case is like one who has got hold of a ring. It is so strong, their hold and the ring itself, that there is no breaking that tie afterwards. That can only happen if there is no compulsion. See, it's a question not of their leaving that, their hold on the ring. It's a question of people trying to make them renegade and return to their old past. And yet they would not, at any risk, they would continue to stick to that, adhere to that ring. And this is the beautiful scenario we find in the Holy, in the just decided. So Islam has no compulsion. That is the basic fundamental concept. Anybody who comes and goes back, these people are also mentioned in the Quran. Not only those who remain steadfast, as I just mentioned, those who, according to the Quran, who believe and then disbelieve. Now, if death was the punishment, immediately you should have read, murder them, destroy them, kill them, condemn them to death. No, no such thing. The Holy Quran says, and then again believe. If they were murdered, how could they again believe? And then again renegade, again renounce. Yet no punishment is meted out to them by the Quran. It says, these, when they die, not murdered, when they die and die in a state of renouncement or denial of Islam, then Allah will punish them. No punishment at the hand of man. So both these examples are sufficient and very powerful argument against what is commonly understood by the mullahs and propagated among the, unfortunately, in ignorant people, that Islam has punishment of death by hanging or whatever means for those who renounce their religion. It is false, it has no authority, no root in the Quran. On the contrary, it is whatever is proved, I have just told you. Now, this is the true Islamic position. And again, there is a very interesting thing. Man irtadda means one who himself has declared himself not to be a Muslim anymore. There is not the slightest hint in the whole of the Holy Quran or any other traditions of the Holy Prophet Islam that somebody is declared by somebody else to have become murtad. See, this is a completely new invention by the brain of the mullahs of later period. In Arabic, irtadda means the one who himself returns to the old faith, the previous position. Never will you find it mentioned that somebody who is made to leave or who is, who is made to renounce Islam or declared to have renounced Islam. There is no such thing. So the mullahs who go on declaring that is not Muslim, that is not Muslim, well, they can enjoy this game if they like. But it has no meaning, no standing in the teachings of the Quran. Okay? Yes, please.
Huzur, we are aware of your great love for Africa. Particularly Sierra Leone.
I hope all Africans are aware of that.
And the last Jalsa,
yes,
yeah, was an indication that you would encourage some sort of investment processes, right, in Africa, Sierra Leone, and other countries. We wanted to know whether this idea is still in your mind.
We have invested certainly in some African countries, despite grave problems, despite failures of some of the enterprises, because of the corruption. You see, it is very difficult to invest in countries where the level of corruption has risen to a degree that everybody wants to eat up the industry as soon as possible. Now, the unfortunate tendency in Africa nowadays is not to wait for the eggs to be laid by the duck which lays the golden eggs, but to rather eat the mother of the eggs, you know. So all industries, if not all, a large number of industries who were installed in Africa at great costs through foreign helps, but help which required repayment of loans later on, came to a very unfortunate end. You see, I give you the example of a textile mill in Ghana, which was one of the most modern mills in the whole world, installed with the help and technical, not only financial, but technical help of Germans, who posted their officers, their mechanics, to make the gun and understand how this circuit should be run and everything. Every precaution was taken by the Germans to make it a success. But when I sent one of my representatives from Pakistan to study the situation of textile industry, he came, returned so disgusted. He said, "What a waste." He said, "Half of the machines have run out of order and there is no repair going on and the labor is in rebellion, no discipline, no management. And the Germans have just abandoned the whole plan and have left the country." And he said, he knows, he has been in this industry for the last 25, 30 years, or maybe more, I don't know, but about that much. He told me that there's a factory of that excellence, it's rare to see. And this was so because Ghana, of all the African countries, is fortunate to produce a quality of cotton which is fully matched, which fully matches the best Egyptian cotton and the best American cotton. Egyptian cotton and American cotton are supposed to be the best, on the very top. And the textile made out of that stuff is excellent, of course, and it fetches the largest prices. So it is said that outside these two countries, Ghana is the one fortunate country whose quality of texture and the tensile qualities of the stuff of cotton is the very best in the world. But this is what happened. So we attempted not only once, twice, three times, to help Ghana by installing of some factories, buy something and then bring it to up to date. Nothing doing. So far we have done one thing. We have made a big project in Uganda, entirely right from zero to the finish. A project by Ahmadis from outside with the help of local Ahmadis from Ghana, Uganda. It's going to be a real good project, a very big one. Then we have, in Sierra Leone, we have bought, you know, a industry which
By Kisi.
When?
By Kisi Dockyard.
That's right, yes. Mm. And the prospects there are very, very good.
Inshallah.
But in Ghana, we have now started helping them by finding underneath water, reaching the subterranean water, because when drought comes to Ghana, then all the advantages of the last few years are totally wiped out and great disaster befalls the country. So we are experimenting on something which is very difficult, but we have got success now ultimately, with the grace of Allah, to tell them how to install hand-driven pumps and to how to make the whole material, and we give them the know-how, etc. And the problem was that there was a large, thick, rocky layer which could not be penetrated previously, So all attempts by the government and other agencies had failed and were abandoned ultimately. But ours has succeeded with the grace of Allah, with prayer and with special blessing from Allah. With the help of some government agencies who bring us heavy machinery to bore through the rock, we have installed successful hand pumps, which in future will be supported by small machines, power-driven machines, etc. And also we have, with the cooperation with some chiefs, we have also worked on some other project in Ghana. We have also installed this homeopathic hospital and homeopathic pharmaceutical industry. And other small attempts are continuously being made, both in Ghana and Sierra Leone and other countries. But the problem again remains the same. Wherever you can successfully install an industry, there are other problems which play a negative role in the success of that, which are not localized, which don't belong to that particular country either. They belong to a group of countries and their policies, etc. For instance, if you want to have a factory of toothpaste, now, toothpaste is a small thing, but it's all imported in the Gambia and other distant countries, Sierra Leone, everywhere it's imported. So I was disgusted. I said, why should go for making and producing toothpaste at least, the minimal requirement of the city life. They told me that if you do it, you'll waste the whole money. This was the opinion of the experts, local experts, non-MD experts. Don't go for it. I said, why? They said, because when you go for making your own industry, the Western countries who export toothpastes of all sorts, they would see to it that your industry fails. Because from the neighboring countries, they will, through illegal means, smuggle large stocks and lower the prices to a degree that any industry which is honest and fair and upright cannot survive. So that was a difficulty, and when we investigated, we found it to be true. Similarly, an attempt was made to install animal feed industry in Nigeria. And there, fortunately, some Ahmadis had attempted before. Unfortunately for them, fortunately for us, because they reported to me that it would fail. Why? Because he said, some people here in this business are very corrupt. They want imported goods to continue. And he told me some tricks, play this and that trick. So why to waste huge money on that? That is the main thing. We are now going for the moral rearmament of Africa. Without that, and this is my message to you as well, without returning to Islamic morals, you cannot survive the present situation, political, economic, otherwise, in emerging states of Africa. All Ahmadi efforts primarily should be devoted to this cause. And Allah bless you. I'm told that the time is over. So. Mubarak sir. Oh, you have brought some cheese from Holland?
Yeah.
And with all these flags?
Yeah.
Which flags? The British flag? Or?
British.
This is British.
The Dutch.
I know. This is Dutch?
Italy.
Where is Sierra Leone?
No.
You chose to present this to me while I was meeting the ceremony,
yeah,
and you forgot.
I thought
only one map is the most important today.
Yeah.
But anyway,
that's MTA flag.
No, that's all right. Still okay. I would like you to share this with me. To save us time, you know, of posting this again and again, why don't you have a few in the first helping? I have some more. I think you like it. This Holland cheese is very, very good indeed. Huh? Have some more. Okay? Sure? And what about you?
I'll have German one.
German one. Please. How do you like it?
It's beautiful.
Oh, it's nice.
Obviously, the time is catching up on us.
No, it has already caught.
I don't know.
It's not catching. I'm told that we are now on borrowed time.
Okay. I mean, all I wanted to ask, obviously, would be your visit to Sierra Leone was such a success, to West Africa was such a success. Whether you do now have any future plans of visit which may help bless the country and perhaps...
At present, I think Germany is passing through a very critical phase.
Yes.
And during this period of the sword of Damocles hanging over every head there, I don't think it will be advisable for me to tour the room. So let's wait a bit more.
A later date. Inshallah.
All right,
thank you very much indeed.
And we take leave of all the viewers and audience.
Yeah. All right.